Doug Fine, thanks for coming and sitting down with me today.
So great to be here with you, Andy.
One of the overarching themes in your film seems to be that hemp can be one of the big answers to combating climate change, thanks to its wide variety of uses, but also that it grows fast and plentiful. So what are some of those uses of the plant, and how can it save humanity from climate change?
First and foremost, hemp's roots are unusually long for an annual. When you harvest a hemp plant, it's unbelievable. You have these like branching out roots, and what they're doing is aerating the soil, and it's really crucial for creating a living space for beneficial microbes. When you have beneficial microbes, you have thriving plants, and then the plants do their job of sequestering carbon. They breathe it the way that we breathe oxygen. So we can quantify it, and I've seen it in the field, and this is in the film. There's a wildfire raging outside one of the hemp fields. It's 100 degrees outside, more than 100 degrees. You go into the hemp field, the air is clear and cooler. You can actually feel the carbon sequestration. So first and foremost, I would say the roots, but also the application that I love growing for my own family's food security is seed. And this hemp seed, you can get at any grocery store, and it's a genuine superfood. Very high, 30%+ protein, and plentiful in beneficial minerals like selenium and magnesium. So in those two ways, food security and carbon sequestration, it's part of an entourage of plants, but it's a crucial, crucial plant for humanity's future.
So a lot of the film takes place at your Funky Butte Ranch in southern New Mexico. And then towards the beginning of the film, we see you and your wife get your state hemp license. I could sort of feel the emotion that was happening there. What was riding on that permit to get the permit?
It's really interesting. No other superfood, no other crop that you grow besides cannabis hemp requires allowing the government to come and inspect your crop, issue you a permit for a crop. It's a weird system, and I wish that the legacy of the ridiculous war on cannabis were over so that we wouldn't have to get permits at all. But having said that, New Mexico has, since the moment that New Mexico developed a hemp program about 5 years ago, had one of the best in the nation, within the top couple of hemp programs, very farmer friendly in the way that the inspections were done to make sure that THC levels, the psychoactive levels, are within current hemp definitions. So it is a big moment when you're official and you get your permit, and then there's also this sweat, like off your brow moment when you pass the THC test in the middle of the season, then you know you can actually harvest the crop. I'm really big on taking the burden off the farmers. It's all that stuff, I think, would be wonderful if it went away and we just let farmers grow their crops.
Later on in the film, there's another scene where you visit this 3D printing operation where they're using hemp material to make what looks like to be sort of a plastic type material. Mm-hmm. It might take some viewers to wrap their heads around it, but my brain first went to like maybe Cheech and Chong are onto something. You know, from the movie Up in Smoke, they're driving around this big truck made out of cannabis. So maybe they saw the future. I don't know, but now we know that it's possible. Why aren't we seeing more widespread production of hemp in that way?
Well, first of all, in case it helps viewers, I rarely travel without the hemp printed goat. This is 3D printed from U.S. grown hemp, Goodbye Pacific Garbage Patch, compostable. It can be made in all different kinds of strengths of plastic, so you don't need those petrochemicals. And if we really think about our supply chain as customers, that's what's going to, I hope, reach the critical mass. Even my pants and TMI alert, my underwear today are made from hemp. This renewable and easy to grow crop. So as for why is it not more implemented, it's about critical mass and chicken and egg. Certain amount of acreage has to be grown in order to have enough feedstock to feed expensive processing machinery. And really just educating customers that you could go to a box store and buy pesticide soaked imported cotton. Mm-hmm. Or you could actually go and seek out clothing or food of all kinds, not even just hemp, that's made, grown by local farmers. If you think about that, you know, you might be paying a little bit more going in, but the flip side of the whole saying pay the farmer now rather than the doctor later is something we really live by. So it's about individual families deciding they're going to work regenerative materials and food into their budget.
You also went and visited George Washington's famous Mount Vernon estate and saw, I believe, the first hemp crop there in centuries, I think is what you mentioned in the film. And it seems to be sort of a big turning point for hemp manufacturing, hemp growth, that it's coming back to this place that was famously, you know, that famously grew hemp there for a long time. What did you learn there in terms of how integral hemp was for our first president?
It was an amazing experience. I feel so lucky that the longtime manager of the estate, Dean Norton, had read one of my hemp books and invited me just to be part of this harvest, not knowing that I was making a film. And so we got into colonial clothes, harvested with super sharp colonial era scythes. They're really sharp. I like still have a scar from harvesting not carefully enough. And the importance of hemp in his journals to George Washington was undeniable. But as far as what I learned most, it was yet another use of hemp that I didn't know about. People think of some of the more common uses for hemp, even that we've discussed, food, clothing. George Washington made most of his money through his fishing fleet in the Potomac River, and his nets were made from hemp. The boats that were used in the fishing were caulked with hemp seed oil. So hemp was vital for him concretely in making a living. So this was the first, we documented in the film, the first hemp harvest at Mount Vernon since 1799. And it was awesome experience to be part of.
I've been covering sort of cannabis legalization here for a number of years now. What I'm hearing these days are some rumblings of how is New Mexico going to put itself on the map when interstate commerce becomes a thing. I feel like CBD and hemp is already there, considering it's on a different legal standard. And I feel like CBD and hemp products are sort of ubiquitous in stores these days. But not much of it is local. Correct me if I'm wrong. But if that's the case, how can local hemp farmers sort of get a leg up, get their products onto shelves so that when we go to the local boutique store here in Albuquerque, we know that it's grown locally?
That's a great question. The first model that comes to mind is Hatch Green Chili. It's done such a remarkable job, deservedly. It's awesome. We love it. Marketing itself worldwide. And that is about local farmers growing in a place. And so using that model, New Mexico, as someone who's written about and covered in this film, hemp and cannabis all over the country and all over the world, what we have in New Mexico is the land of enchantment, the local grown kind of real genuine spirit, people that are super friendly. We have red or green sauce in our New Mexico restaurants. Taking that mentality in, I think, is a competitive advantage for our cannabis and hemp farmers versus what are known as MSOs, multi-state operations. And it's fine, I'm grateful for cannabis hemp returning in all its forms, but just as I shop at a farmer's market or food co-op rather than a box store for my vegetables, that's how I hope visitors to the state and even folks within the state who are shopping for hemp cannabis will seek out those locally produced, ideally organic, but certainly regenerative mode local hemp products. I want to shout out High Lonesome Farms out of Silver City. They do a great job with hemp and cannabis products. And, you know, since I live in southern New Mexico, up here in northern New Mexico, I'm sure there's a ton of farm to product. So I would urge folks to just look for, as you say, those farm to shelf, farm to product hemp and cannabis products, even when there is competition, and look for more than just that immediate price tag. Look for locally produced, just like you would for Hatch chilies. You wouldn't want your green chilies coming from somewhere else.
So sometimes we might have to pay a little bit more to be sort of socially conscious and supporting our local farms, right?
Maybe so too. If you're taking the time to take your family to a farmer's market for hemp or other products, maybe you're not even paying that much more. Mm. If you're just investing, and we make it our tourism to go and shop for food in a place, you know, local food in a place.
As I was watching this, it occurred to me that you seem to be having a lot of fun doing this. Not just making the film, but growing hemp and supporting your family through this. You're doing cartwheels in the film, you're dancing, you're wearing costumes, you play the saxophone. I think you call it tooting your saxophone for your plants. How easy is it for, say, you know, the average New Mexico PBS correspondent to just ditch everything and go start a hemp farm?
I would say that you're right, that fun is definitely part of the brand. We finds, my family and I love our life. Being outside with pollinators is the most fun you can have outside the bedroom. And focusing on family to begin with, we homeschool our kid, I advise it to folks as a way to live a really happy life. But as for what anybody can do, every acre of regeneratively cultivated hemp sequesters tons of carbon. So if you have a rooftop space in a city or just a patch that you can drip, irrigate, and plant hemp on, of course, at this stage, you have to get a permit even for a home subsistence crop, but hopefully, you know, follow the regulations, but hopefully those type of things are going away. Everybody can actually play a concrete role, and your own food will be healthier. That's this coming back to the family, coming back to home. I'm so glad you asked that question, because in the end, I feel when we have these jars and jars of hemp seed that we can put into our yogurt that comes from our goats, cutting the carbon miles out of it, we're not fully food independent by any stretch, and we take two steps forward, one step back a lot. But it's a remarkable feeling, and it's whether it's psychological or really truly nutritive, we feel like we're getting more nutrient dense food when you love the plants and you're talking to them, or in my case, playing bad saxophone at them. I think it does actually result in happier plants, because I don't consider myself to have an extremely green thumb, and yet these plants keep coming up and giving my family food. So I was really grateful at the Santa Fe Film Festival, the American Hemp Farmer film premiered and won this award, and I got called onto the stage and got this Nambe award, and I had to say something, and I thanked, besides obvious family and casting crew, the microbes and the sun and the plants, because they're providing life for my family.
You reference yourself as a midwife, I think, in there, right? Just right. To sort of facilitate it. So what's next for the film, and where can people find it right now?
It's a fun journey for me to have now take this stage after print journalism, radio journalism, and book authoring to move into film and have this immediate, with the first film, first premiere, have a little bit of justification. I'm so grateful, always will be grateful, for Santa Fe Film Festival for accepting this film, because you start to get return calls. So now I'm in this fun honeymoon phase of a learning process of how you market a film. Like everything else, television and film markets are evolving extremely rapidly. So our hope is that there's PBS watchers at Netflix who want to pick up this film. We really want to get this message of having fun while sequestering carbon and living a regenerative life out, because it's, I do think, you know, you don't want to be too grandiose. It's a potential hope for humanity. If everybody is thinking about local food and non, you know, destructive industrial pipeline products, then maybe actually humanity has a chance of thriving post-petroleum.
Okay. Well, great. Thank you again so much for coming in and talking with me today.
Great questions. I appreciate you having me.
Thanks.